Hello everyone, this is Frank Porter again from TPG. We're at the top of the hour and we're ready for our next webinar. It will be given by TPG's own Matthew Atkinson, and the theme is Accessibility Grindhouse. A little information about Matthew. He came to TPG from an academic background, having worked on research projects improving computer and communication accessibility for older people and affording vision-impaired and blind gamers access to mainstream computer games and 3D level editing tools. He also enjoyed teaching JavaScript, HTML, and CSS. He's experienced in applying accessibility standards to a range of websites, web, and native applications. From his research, he's keen to ensure that the information is conveyed as appropriately, robustly, and engagingly as possible, and as such, takes a keen interest in providing accessible user experiences and personalization. Matthew holds a Ph.D. in computer science and actively develops and contributes code to open source projects. So I guess we can say the doctor is in the house. Matthew, it's all yours.
Hi, everybody. Hopefully you can hear me okay. I'm not sharing my desktop. I've uploaded the PowerPoint file, and I can see that that's slightly damaged our logo, so apologies to Mike Passiello for half of the logo being missing there. Anyway, this is two little presentations rather than one big one, because I couldn't decide what to talk about. So you've got two different little stories, two tales of frighteningly awesome accessibility. The first one is called Dead Simple Headings for Monstrous Mashups. And the second one is called Zooming Against Humanity and Layouts That Fight Back. What we'll do is we'll start with Dead Simple Headings. And after this, we'll have a quick break for questions, and then we'll look at the other story afterwards. Okay, so this one begins with how we used to do, or perhaps sometimes still do, sectioning and headings. There's a bit of a code excerpt here where we're just using divs and H1s and H2s to structure a very short little document, which just got two paragraphs in, and a H1 and a H2. And it looks very simple. That's how we've been writing documents for a long time. I could have perhaps put another div in there, perhaps for the subsection, but generally that's the rough idea, that we use the heading element and specify the level to break up our documents. There are some advantages to that, namely it's very simple, it's direct, but one of the problems with it is it's relatively inflexible in terms of the ways that we now produce web applications, which we'll move on to. So it works, it's simple, but it doesn't have too much flexibility. So how do we do sectioning and heading now? And by now, I mean with HTML5 elements, how would we go about doing this differently? Well, first of all, we're going to revisit this example with two little paragraphs. One of them's got a H1 above it, one of them's got a H2 above it. But I've also introduced a main element to encompass the whole of this content, and a couple of section elements, and they're nested. And that, of course, gives some semantic information about the layout of this document. So for example, the section that's headed with a H2 is inside the section that's headed with a H1, and that shows that the H2 section is subordinate to, but also related to, the H1 main section. And that's kind of current markup and how we would use those heading elements in conjunction with the new section elements that HTML5 provides us. And there are other sectioning elements as well. There's a side, which is for something that's kind of tangentially related to the main topic. And you've also got other elements such as nav. Nav is a sectioning element as well. So there are various different sectioning elements there that imply something about the structure of the document. Now, what's good about this is it provides some semantic information about the structure of the document, but unfortunately, as far as the developer is concerned, there isn't really much instant gratification in the way that they get for actually using that semantic markup. So other than it being best practice and clean markup, there's not too much motivation for them to actually use it. And unfortunately, it still has the inflexibilities that we saw in the first example. And that means that you still have to use H1, H2, you have to prescribe explicitly what level of heading you're talking about. And because of that, there is a principle called the don't repeat yourself principle, which basically means don't provide information, the same information in two different places, because it can lead to errors when things are changed. Now, if we wanted to change the structure of that document, we'd have to change the structure of the sections, and we'd also have to change the H elements, the heading elements, to the appropriate level to make those match the new structure. So there's a bit of a problem there. There are several occasions where you might run into problems. What if the structure of our page changes? We've just talked about that. Or what if we fail to match the visual layout to the semantic heading structure? This can happen a lot. For example, people will miss out levels of headings, or the heading structure, which is the information that somebody using a screen reader, for example, might get, doesn't match how it actually looks on the page. So you get artifacts whereby some sections appear to be from the heading structure, from the outline, they appear to be inside other sections, but actually visually it's quite clear that they're not related. And another more modern concern is, what if we're bringing in content from lots of different sources to make our document, and those all have their own heading structure themselves, so that we end up trying to mash together several different levels of heading structure? It all gets very confusing, and it's quite rigid. There's not very much we can do about it. Now, those three problems are becoming increasingly common, and the problem of missing heading levels in the document outline is illustrated by our next slide. In all of these cases, what happens is you end up with headings that kind of do exist because they're there semantically, but they don't really show up in the document itself. So you could call them zombie headings. They are kind of existing, but not quite. They're not really here, they're not really not here. So there's a zombie as well. As you can see, a tenuous link to the promised subject matter, but there we go. Zombie headings are a big problem for people who are trying to navigate about the site, or who can only navigate about the site through things like the heading structure in the document outline, as opposed to the visual structure. People who are using screen readers and assistive technologies, they don't get many more than one element at a time. So they have to move through the page very laboriously, one element at a time. And the heading structure is one of the key things that can be used to help them navigate. And all too often you get these missing headings or misleading headings. So what can we actually do about this? And can we solve our problem in relation to mashups and making the code easier for ourselves to write? Well, one approach would be the HTML5 outline algorithm. What that says is, if you've got a series of sections in your document, in theory, you're supposed to be able to just use a H1 under every section, and magically the browser will work out what the document outline should be and apply the appropriate heading element in reality. So the first heading on this sample is a H1, the second one will be converted to a H2, the third would be converted to H3, and so on. Unfortunately, that was an idea put forward by the specification people at the W3C, but no browser has actually implemented it, so you can't rely on it. It's just a fantasy at the moment, hence the unicorn there with the rainbow of H1s coming out of it. You can't rely on the document outline as a means to correct this problem for you. So what can we do then? It looks like we need a universal heading element, and such a thing has been proposed before but never really made it into a standard. So we made one called W3C-heading. Now, an ideal name for this sort of thing would probably be simply H, but unfortunately, because this is made of a custom element, you're not actually allowed to call things just H or just a single letter. So that's why it's called W3C heading, for now at least. And what does it do? Well, let's look at our example from before, where we've got two nested, a section with a nested subsection. I've replaced the H1 and the H2 by W3C-heading elements. Both of the headings in each of the sections are marked up as W3C-headings. But if you look at the nesting of the sections, the second W3C heading is subordinate to the first one. But we didn't have to specify that in our code. Let's have a look what that looks like. I'm now showing a screenshot, and it just looks like rendered in the browser as if there was a H1 and a H2, because the W3C heading element by default styles itself according to the matching HTML heading element. So it looks as if a H1 and a H2 has been used. Okay, so we're not much further on from where we were before, because we may have solved the problem of making a document outline more easily and having that inferred from the section elements. But there's also the issue of, what about people using assistive technologies? Will they be told the right information about the heading levels? Let's just go back briefly to the code that we actually wrote there, which was just two W3C-heading elements used in the place of a H1 and an H2. That's the code that we actually wrote. Now, the code that the browser actually sees as a result of using our custom element is more like this. What happens is the role of heading, that's an ARIA role, which you will have learnt about, or you will, or you may be about to learn about in the watching the recaps of these presentations. The ARIA role of heading is applied to each one of these elements, so that assistive technologies and browsers know that it's meant to be a heading. And the level attribute is applied to indicate which actual level of importance the heading has. And as is the tradition when doing a presentation like this, I'm sure the clever people will spotted that the ARIA dash is missing from before the level attribute. I would love to be able to say that's because I wanted it to fit on one line, but it was omitted as an oversight. However, you don't need to worry about it, because the whole point of using custom elements, and in particular this one, is it's accessible out of the box. So you don't need to worry about specifying what level the heading is. It knows what level it is, and it will work out the correct attributes to add for the information of the browser and the assistive technologies. So you don't actually have to write this code. It's just added behind the scenes for you, and you'll never actually see it in your document. So that's the good news with using custom elements like this one. You can also style headings, and then you do need to know the name of the attribute that's used. In this case, I'm styling level 2 headings with green color, and what that looks like is, as before, I'm showing a screenshot from the browser where it looks like there's a H1 and a H2 been used, and the H2 in this case is green because the CSS changed the color of the H2 to green. So the heading elements can be styled in many different ways. You don't need to stick with the default font sizes or anything like that. That's just an example of how you might want to change it. So in summary, this is an element called W3C heading. It works with HTML5 sectioning elements. That's article, section, aside, and nav. It knows the level of heading that it's at within the document outline. It reports that level and the role of heading to assistive technologies. It means that when you bring in bits of documents from other sources that have their own structure already, they just work and the whole document outline is worked out automatically. It means that the developer gets some benefit from using this in that they don't need to keep track of which heading level they're using, and when they change the document around, they don't need to worry about the changing of the heading elements as well as the changing of the document structure, and there are fabulous prizes to be won. So in summary, please consider using W3C heading, or if you are interested, please consider supporting or contributing to the spec. We're writing, I should say that Steve Faulkner, my colleague who originated the idea for this element, is writing a spec for it so that maybe it will be adopted in future, who knows. If not, at least you'll have some good documentation. And please help us develop it, suggest features, report bugs, write code, and maybe this will make it into a future HTML spec. So that's the conclusion of the first part of this presentation, and therefore it's a good point to stop and ask if anyone has any questions.
Matthew, I don't see any questions. There was one, but Steve Faulkner and Steve Lee jumped on it already, and I think Kyle as well. So right now, I don't see any questions on this portion of your presentation.
Okay, I will just mention a little bit more technical detail just for those that are interested. There's a link displayed on the slide there to the GitHub repository where this code is stored. It's very simple. It's based on Polymer. That's the web component library slash platform that it uses. So it's based on Polymer, and the code is there. You can have a fiddle with it. And if you have any questions about features, bugs, suggestions, anything like that, please do check out that repository. There's also a demo page that shows you exactly how to use the element and what the resultant code looks like from the document perspective. And also, if you use the inspection tools in the browser, then you can see how the browser actually perceives these heading elements as well. So if there aren't any more questions, I'll give it a couple of seconds and see if there's any more questions. But if there aren't, we'll move on. Just give it a little bit longer. Okay, nobody's got any burning issues on this one, so that haven't been dealt with already, I should say. But please let us know in the future if you do have any questions. So moving swiftly onwards, we've talked about dead simple headings, and the next portion of this talk, I should have said, this is a slide for questions. Nobody had any, nobody has any still, so I'll carry on moving on. The next section of this is called Zooming Against Humanity and Layouts That Fight Back. This is really from the perspective of a disgruntled user of various web-related technologies, and actually it's about the supposed theorized evil genius that is plotting against them in their progress through the web. There's some great technologies coming along and already available for doing layouts, and this is about how not to use them. Okay, so we're going to play the bad guy for this little story. And the overview of the goals of zooming against humanity is as follows. First of all, we very much don't want to allow users to choose their own font size. We also don't want to allow them to actually be able to read the content that they've been looking for once they've found it. A third aim is to ensure that users have to scroll so much that they go nuts, get motion sickness, or their arms actually fall off. And the last goal that we're going to be looking at is to make sure that whatever works today in terms of these technologies and access breaks tomorrow, or actually preferably even today if you can manage it. So we'll look at each one of these situations and see how we can bamboozle the user with it. The first thing to remember though is that the web should never ever flex to fit the user's needs. That's what we're really aiming for here when we want to zoom against humanity. So the first thing is we don't want users to be able to set font sizes, and it seems that in this we're already defeated when it comes to desktop computers and laptop or notebook computers, because actually they do provide ways for people to customize the font size both at the operating system level and in the browser. So that doesn't look particularly good for us. But fortunately, many users aren't even aware that they can do this. They don't know that their operating system might provide them a function to change the font size or set the screen resolution differently or zoom in, use a different DPI setting, for example. They don't know about that, and they also don't know that they can zoom in the browser. And this might be a generational thing, so we might have to watch out in future, but it seems that some people who are used to things like physical artifacts that are not very mutable, they're not very flexible, they feel when they get introduced to computers that they're just probably very similar. And it doesn't occur to people that it might be able to flex to fit their needs. So don't tell them. The challenges that we face as evil geniuses in this area are that some researchers and developers are actually trying to improve this. The RDWG at the W3C has been looking at text customization for a while. And also, terrible institutions such as the BBC have got free guides available to help people actually change the computer settings so that they can better access the web. So we're not too pleased about that. And also the prevalence or the increasing availability of Zoom widgets and things in prominent places in browser user interfaces is very troubling. But largely though, still looking pretty good, even on the desktop and laptop computers where, you know, you might think that we've already got our work cut out for us. So that's the story on the classical desktop type computers. How about mobiles? Well, if we search for people trying to change the font size on iPhone, and an Android one is coming up, just to be fair, I searched for iPhone change font size. And whilst many of the articles have the words change and font size in them, most of them are about increasing the font size. So this indicates that people are very interested in increasing the font size on their iPhones. And here's a similar slide for Androids. In fact, they even have some apps to help people do that, which is just terrible if you want to bamboozle them in that area. So that's the state of play on mobile, is that people are asking how to do it. Unfortunately for them, and great for us, our work is already done, because most mobiles don't actually let you change the font size of content in the browser. Some of them do in certain apps that have been written specially to support a larger font size, but most of them don't actually let you change the font size in the browser. So that's great, our work is done. And just to put the icing on the cake, it's important to also stop people from being able to zoom in using their favorite zoom in gestures as well, but we'll come to that soon. Challenges forecast in this area for evildoers are that future mobile browsers may well allow users a choice in font size. We just don't know. Moving on to the next strategy, which is one that I've been affected by personally. This isn't at all a personal vendetta here, but when you finally found what you're looking for, especially if it's on a mobile browser, you might be in a rush, you might be in a difficult situation, you want an answer quickly, you've managed to get through the searching interface to find the content that you want, and then you can't zoom in. And if anybody can actually read the text that's on that mobile screen, then they can have several geek points. I can't. This is a real good one. So make sure you get your users with this. And it's very easy to do as well. So I'll show you how. The overall strategy is just when the user has found your site, knows who you are, and wants to know more, disable pinch to zoom. And the advantages of this are that your layout is kept pixel perfect and unusable to most people, so they won't be able to make any sort of comments or anything on your content because they won't be able to actually access it. There is some problem with this if the user does have their reading glasses or scanning tunneling electron microscope to hand, it won't work, but we just hope to catch them on off guard there. So what's really good about this, it annoys all the users that we met before who want to change their font size, but it also annoys those people with good sight who are perhaps in suboptimal reading environments, and that's just when they want to find the information that they need. So that's really good. And the challenges, however, it has to be said, there are some challenges in this area. Some devices have built-in zoom features, although in a kind of delightful twist of irony, most people aren't aware of those, or they're labeled or hidden under many different layers of menus in the settings box. Most of them require at least 42 fingers to do the zoom gestures, and they also pixelate, so that's wonderful. When you zoom in, you actually get quite a fuzzy picture sometimes if you need a big zoom level. So probably not worth worrying about those challenges, really. So I'll move on to how do you actually make sure this works. If you want to ruin people's days, make sure that you set maximum scale in the viewport tag, meta tag, and this is an example of how to do that. You may be familiar with setting the content of this tag to width equals device width, initial scale equals 1, and the key bit is maximum scale equals 1, and that means they can't zoom in. If you leave out maximum scale, it means that your user can do pinch to zoom, and then their day will not be ruined. So we'll move swiftly onwards from that. Also, you ought to watch out for this upcoming CSS. The at viewport directive is now quite well through being standardized, and it is getting increasing support. Internet Explorer started this off, I believe, and there are other browsers now following suit. So make sure that you don't see CSS like this, because this is very helpful as well. We don't want to be helpful. So moving on to the next heading. This is where we talk about destructo scrolling, and this is where we give the user so much scrolling. I mean, scrolling is good, isn't it? Users like to scroll, and this is where we give the user so much scrolling that they just can't take it anymore. Here is a representation of looking at a web page on a web browser. There's just a box. That's the web browser with the web page in it. Now, what happens if either the user makes the font size bigger, or, as is often the case, there is more content on the page than will fit? What you get quite often is the page drops down below where you can see in the browser, and you use scrolling to go up and down and move about the page. And that's really quite useful. It's also only one-dimensional scrolling, which means that it's quite easy for most users to do. For example, you can do it with a mouse wheel, or you can do it with a gesture on a trackpad, or you can even use the arrow keys or some other method. It only requires a couple of key presses or strokes of the finger, so it's very easy to do. Some people do have problems with it if they've got motor dexterity issues, but for the most part, scrolling in one direction is okay. So what happens in the case that this newfangled full page zoom gets used? Quite often, web browsers these days, they'll zoom the whole page rather than just the text, and they'll preserve the layout and the spatial relationships between the things in the layout. And what that means is that when you enlarge that, the page actually gets bigger in two directions. So what that means is the user has to scroll up and down and left and right, and they have a kind of panning effect around this larger web page that exists. And that's really helpful, because if you want people to miss information, what you should do is make sure that it's kind of off the screen and also off to one of the sides as well, because users are less likely to be able to find it there. So make sure that you put any important links off to the side, so that people who are zoomed in probably won't get to that. Now that can be a bit difficult to cope with for some people, because it's all this panning about a larger screen. Now, if we just go back to the start and consider somebody who's using a screen magnifier, what that means is they're already zoomed in to a small part of the web browser. So this is even before the page gets big. The user is zoomed into a small part of it, and they are panning around left, right, up and down, just to see the page as it is now. So if they need bigger text and the layout gets enlarged as it did before, we get this panning inside panning, or panning on top of panning, or two layers of panning, or second order scrolling and all that sort of stuff. What it means is the user is scrolling around their screen just to see the content in the first place, but they are also scrolling around this larger content, and we have two different levels of scrolling on top of each other. And this quite often happens with PDFs that haven't been made with the fluidic layout, which is most of them, unfortunately. Anything sort of fixed in layout, if you're using a screen magnifier, it can cause this twofold panning and zooming phenomenon. And that really just results in two things. First of all, it results in the user getting very confused and possibly motion sickness afflicted by this. So the user's there getting very dizzy, and it's just a matter of time until their fuse blows and they get very mad. And so that's destructo scrolling, and it works very effectively. Now, how do we actually apply this? Well, full screen zoom is very cool, so just carry on doing it. Challenges to this technique are when developers use flexible units such as EMS, or make their layouts work with text only zoom, the users then get away with only one dimensional scrolling. So that gets them back off the hook, and the scrolling is nice and easy, and it's easy for them to navigate. So we certainly wouldn't want that to happen. Of course, we're talking about the general case here. Sometimes full screen zoom really is cool, but think about it before you rely on it. And we'll also move on to, in a very short while, discuss progressive enhancement, because that's a really big challenge to all of this. All of our evil plans are threatened by this, actually, so I'll cover that shortly. Now, there's a related issue here, which is that when users get used to using something on a desktop, or a laptop, they expect it to work on a mobile as well. Now, it won't necessarily look the same, but it should be able to behave the same, or at least enable them to do the most important things that they want to be able to do. Now, a really good technique is to lull these users into a false sense of security. By that, I mean when things go from desktop to mobile, take important features away, because that's really annoying to them and it might give them a headache. Also, something that works on one mobile device might not necessarily work on another, and that's another aspect of this false sense of security. For example, it's really fun to do things like take important features such as being able to change your password through the mobile site away. There were certain high-profile websites that didn't let people do this, and it caused a lot of problems for them when they were not able to access a computer of a desktop or laptop nature. So make the mobile thing different, behave differently, perhaps carry out fewer functions than the desktop version. And another thing to bear in mind, though, is that responsive design can be used to make things legible on mobiles or tablets, and progressive enhancement might even make them very usable as opposed to just legible and moderately usable. So those are things to watch out for. I will warn you about those in a bit more later. Responsive design, from a CSS point of view, looks a bit like this sometimes. You do a media query and you say that whatever's next in your style sheet, it applies to a device, in this case, that has a minimum width of 500 pixels. And then there's another one below here that says the following CSS applies to a screen with a maximum width of 800 pixels. And this is really clever because it means that you can target things at the devices. So that presents a challenge for us, because as evil geniuses, we don't want people to be able to actually use stuff on mobiles and tablets. So something that targets a particular device is a bit of a headache for us. Although there is a silver lining, because targeting devices in pixel terms means that when new devices come out later on, the layout might well be hideously broken on those devices. So, basically. If you're not careful with responsive design, you can fall into a bit of a device trap. In some cases, it makes sense. In some cases, it doesn't. There is, however, a new approach, or a relatively new approach, which is going to cause us, as evil geniuses, even more headaches. And that's progressive enhancement, which is to start off by thinking about what's the essential experience on a mobile or a tablet, and then build on that to get to the desktop and laptop layout in the end, or big screen layout. Probably best to stop using the terms like desktop and laptop, because it might be a TV, it might be something else. Now, doing it that way around means that you don't accidentally or on purpose miss out anything that's important to people when they're using it on the mobile. And there's a further twist to this that gets even worse for people who are trying to make users' lives difficult, or inadvertently by accident do so. And that is, if you do your content, if you do your media queries in terms of the content, so for example, doing the breaks between layouts when it makes sense for the content in terms of the size of the content that can be fit on the screen, for example, in this case, 42 M's, so that's 42 sort of average size characters wide, that's when this breakpoint will occur. If you do it that way around, it means that the content always will look okay, and when new devices come and go and different form factors come and go, it's a bit more robust against those sorts of changes, because you thought about the breakpoints of the content primarily. So that's a progressive enhancement with M-based media queries, and the challenges for us are that layouts targeted at the content always look good, or at least most of the time, and this isn't looking very good if we want to spoil people's days, because this technique really does help. And there is actually one more thing. I mentioned a while ago about destructo scrolling and how utterly confusing it can be for people using screen magnifiers, let alone people who are just scrolling, panning within a larger picture, horizontally and vertically. Well, there's one more thing about progressive enhancement and particularly M-based media queries, and that is, I've taken these examples from a blog article, which I'm going to link to later. This is a website that has a layout. It's being shown on a desktop browser, and currently it's in an unzoomed or at least default font size state. If we were to zoom in by making the font size bigger, that layout gets a little bit messed up. In fact, what happens here is that the navigation splits onto two lines and the contrast isn't very good because the background doesn't work out properly. This is actually one of the least disrupted layouts by increasing font size that I've seen, but it's still not very usable in comparison to the first one that we saw. Now, what happens if we were to use, this uses a pixel-based media query, what happens if we were to use an M-based media query? Let's just hop back to the original layout. If we need to make this so big, because we can't see very well, that the font size is really huge and it would break the layout, well, if you happen to be using M-based media queries, all of a sudden, the browser will realize, hold on, this content is not fitting on the screen, and it will switch down to, in this case, a mobile or tablet layout. So the font is bigger and the site is more legible and the layout is not broken. And that's very cool for people who are using screen magnifiers, for example, or people that just like big fonts or less distraction when they're browsing the web, because when the layout flips down to being more elegant, more streamlined, simpler, that just makes readability really good, and it stops the this horrible sort of panning effect that you get, especially useful for screen magnifier users, but helpful to everyone to only have to scroll in one dimension. So that's really useful. And of course, because of the progressive enhancement philosophy, that means that when it does switch down to the, I say switch down, it's not really switching down, it's just changing to the mobile layout, there's nothing negative about it, because it's still going to do the things that people need to do, because that's the one they started off with designing in the first place. So for evil geniuses, that really does mean game over, and it's great for all of the rest of us who are using all sorts of different devices and assistive technologies. The article that I got those pictures from was called The M's Habit. I also wrote an article summarizing various different things that I found about progressive enhancement and M-based media queries, and there's a URL to that there as well. But if you only have time to read one thing, definitely read The M's Habit. And bear in mind that browsers have moved on a great deal since that was written, and the problems and shortcomings that were listed there no longer apply largely. So, are there any questions on that one?
There is a question that I see posted, Matthew. Any views on how to balance ease of magnification against the very useful idea of white space, which can be important for many dyslexic users?
That's a fantastic question. One of the problems with all the stuff that's available to help people view the web and access the web is that people generally aren't very aware of it. For example, you could use custom style sheets to try and change things, although that generally has to be very coarse and not really site specific. In this particular case, if you've got a layout that has lots of white space, then there may be a tension between that and people that have a screen magnifier, because they would have to do less scrolling if there was more text on the page. It's a very interesting trade-off, and the most important thing to be to bear in mind is that as a web developer, the best you can do is make sure that your content is as adaptable as possible, and that means doing things like abiding by best practices, using semantic markup, for example, going back to the headings, using proper headings, and generally just following the best practices as best you can. Now, Google's latest iteration of apps has an interesting feature whereby you can change the layout to balance between the amount of white space that's there versus the amount of content that can fit on the screen. And even though I'm a screen magnifier user, I generally have it set to pretty spaced out because generally they've also made it so that you don't need to scroll in two directions. So I think perhaps the most important thing I would say is try and eliminate two-dimensional scrolling where possible, because even then, if you have lots of white space, it's much more manageable and it doesn't matter who you are. There's a really big tension between how much should a web dev be doing and how much should the browser be doing. Because, for example, lots of websites have controls in them, implemented in the website, to change its color scheme and its font size. And the reason is because it's easier for people to find it there than it is in the browser. But it already exists in the browser. So it's very much not an easy issue to solve. There's whose responsibility it is, and when people don't see those controls in the website, that might make them think that they can't do it on that website, even though they could through the browser, for example. Loads of issues come up there, and I suppose in terms of practical advice, all I could say is try and eliminate the 2D scrolling, try and use M-based media queries and progressive enhancement, and that's going to get you as the best you can do out of the box right now. Hopefully that answers your question. And are there any more questions?
I don't see any posted right now, Matthew. We might want to give it a minute or so to see if anyone else has any questions. There are folks typing. They may just be saying, great job, I'm not sure.
I suppose I could be a little bit controversial in the time that we've got left and say, does anybody have a really good counterexample as to where they think this really shouldn't be used? I mean, it's things aren't necessarily just black and white. What I've tried to talk about is very general. Generally, it's a really bad idea to disable pinch to zoom. Generally, it's a really good idea to use progressive enhancement and M-based media queries. But I suppose, in some cases, if you think there's a genuine case, then by all means, try and articulate it.
Matthew, we have one request. One person is asking if you could go back one screen so they could catch the URLs.
Yeah, of course. That's a very good idea.
Maybe we'll give it another minute, Matthew, to see if any other questions pop up. You're just getting a lot of thumbs up and thank yous right now, Matthew. Nice job.
I'm very glad you enjoyed it. Of course, I'm happy to follow up on Twitter if you do have any sort of genuine concerns about any of this stuff. I am very open to further discussion. If now isn't the time or the place, then I am on Twitter. I'd be happy to answer any questions or have any sort of ongoing discussion.
Very good, Matthew. Our boss, Mike Passiello, has now termed you the new mad scientist. How about that?
Oh, brilliant. I just got over my newbie reputation, and then now I've gone and got another one.